Thank you. I have an amazing story. I cannot wait to tell you. Do any of you out there have a hard job? I have a very difficult job. It's not so much physically demanding as it is emotionally and mentally draining. Don't get me wrong, I love what I do, but sometimes I just gotta get away. On December 10th of 2017, my form of getting away was rafting. You're probably looking at me and wondering, who goes rafting in December? Well, lots of people do, just usually in warmer climates. But imagine you're in the water, you're next to your best friend, there's nobody else around. The only sound you hear is your oars dipping in and out of the water. You're staring up at these beautiful cliff walls when you hear, "Help! Help!" And of course, my first reaction was not the best. I'm like, it's my day off! Well, before you judge me, let me tell you a little bit about myself. I was 25 years old, just got out of a dead-end relationship, and I was working in the restaurant industry when I went on this amazing raft trip, and I was hooked. I decided to sell everything, move to Salida, Colorado, and become a raft guide. I did that for a couple years until I met a beautiful girl. And I still remember that day when she whispered into my ears, "Robbie, I don't think rafting is the best plan for our family's future." She was right. I went back to school, I got my nursing degree. I worked in the emergency department for 10 years. Eventually, I got my master's and started working in family practice medicine, hence my stress. When I worked in the ER, it was great. If you didn't know what was wrong with somebody, you just said, follow up with your primary care provider. Well, now that's me. Let me tell you a little bit about Tyson. Tyson's an amazing guy. He's a respiratory therapist that's worked at multiple Trauma One hospitals. He has to get away as well, although his form of getting away is driving down to Mexico, walking all the way to Canada. Unfortunately, he doesn't do this on roads. He's got to find major mountain ranges to cross, like the Rockies, the Sierra Nevadas, hence why we were boating in December. I promised him we were going rafting. It took him till late November to get to Canada. So we chose the Gunnison Gorge. The reason we chose that, it's a dam-fed section, and it was the only area that wasn't iced over. So the Gunnison Gorge, let me just tell you a little bit about it. It's an extension of the Black Canyon National Park. It's a very deep canyon with very fast water that goes through it. There's an upper gorge that's got class 2, class 3 rapids. It opens up into an area called Ute Park. Then it goes down to 5 more miles in the lower gorge where you have multiple class 3, class 4 rapids, 3 of which we're planning on scouting. And if you don't know the whole rafting scene, scouting means we're going to pull over, we're going to get out of our boat, we're going to look down upon the rapid and figure out how the heck we're going to make it through. After that, you have maybe 4 miles of still water to tell you get to the takeout. The logistics are pretty daunting as well. Basically, what you have to do is drive an hour off-road on 4-wheel drive, high clearance road until you come to a trail called Chucker. You then put all your gear on your back and you hike down to the river. On this particular day, our gear included my cat, a frame, 2 inflatable kayaks, and all the gear you would need to raft in December. So we got down to the bottom, and this is where our problem started. Our friend Logan, the amazing doctor, Eagle Scout, ultimate outdoorsman, threw up for the second time, and we decided that this wasn't just a fluke. So we planned for him to hike out, and we would haul all his gear down to him with us. So the problem was it started taking us a lot of time. And if you know, in December, we don't have much light. And let me give you a little bit of a hint about rafting. going through rapids when it's dark is not very easy. So let me tell you about Adam. Adam is a husband and a father of three young boys. He is a school teacher in a local high school, and he needs to get away as well. Although his form of getting away was hiking down Bobcat Trail, starting to fish, figured out it wasn't as good as he would like. He decided to traverse a bunch of cliffs to head to this other spot, and he didn't make it. The way he describes this was that he lost his footing and fell, and he was in the air, and he noticed time pass. So he knew he had fallen a ways. He landed, and his first thought was, hey, I'm okay. Then he noticed that he couldn't stand up. He noticed that his wrist didn't work. He reached into his bag, and he grabbed out his phone, made a call, no cell phone service. Text, no service. He'd been waiting there about 20, 25 minutes when I'm sure he realized that he wasn't going to make it. So he texted out a letter to his family saying, I'm so sorry I'm not going to be with you, but know always that I love you. Well, then a cranky raft guy came around the corner with his friend. We saw him there, and the first thing we did was said, hey, who we were, and told him what we did, and of course asked if we could help him. And of course he said yes. So I get up there, and I start my trauma assessment. He's got a deformity to his leg. He's got bones sticking out of his wrist. He's got a big hole in his face. The good news is that he can move his hands, he can move his feet, and he's talking to us. The bad news is that in 3 hours, we're all going to die of exposure, and there's no way we can get rescue into this spot. So we have to move him. In emergency medicine, we know that in a trauma case, if the victim's core temperature drops below 35 degrees Celsius, outcomes are very, very poor. So we have to keep him warm. Luckily, I'm kind of a Boy Scout too. I brought 25 hand warmers. So here I am placing hand warmers near any major vessels I can, 25 of them. We load him into Logan's sleeping bag, and we put him on top of a Tyson's boat to use it as a gurney and put Logan's boat on top to protect him from the water. We strap him into the back of the boat. So I jump in, I start rowing, and I'm going through rapids, just trying not to get the guys in the back wet. Here's Tyson in the back, and he's doing a combination of neuro checks, memorizing Adam's wife's phone number and kind of keeping the mood light, like singing the phone number or something like 8675309. By the way, that is not Catherine's phone number. Do not call that phone number. Oops, sorry, wrong one. So we get to Ute Park, and we lift the boat and him all the way up onto the shore. At this point, I got to do the thing that I'm scared the most to do. So I reach into Logan's bag, and I pull out a spot beacon. And if you guys don't know what a spot beacon, basically it's a GPS device where it does one of two things. It either says, hey, I'm okay, or it says, SOS, get me out of here, and a signal goes to an outside company that coordinates with local rescue. My friend Logan got this because he volunteered in Sierra Leone, you know, back when Ebola was a thing. So here's how this went. He gets a phone call. Hey, this is the spot company. Hey, Logan, you're okay. We were so worried. Your spot beacon must have accidentally went off. He's like, no, I'm not okay. I have friends down in the bottom of the gorge that must have hit the beacon. So he eventually tells his wife, who contacts my beautiful wife, Bree, and she tells her, hey, we don't know what happened, but the boys hit the spot beacon. I can only imagine how she felt. So here is Tyson and me sitting at the side of the river, staring across the way and watching the daylight slowly creep away. And then we hear this beautiful sound. It's the sound of a helicopter. And we're kind of debating between ourselves because we know a lot of medical personnel. We're debating who the flight nurse is going to be and if we're going to know them. The helicopter lands and out comes a girl named Kelly, who just happens to be my cousin. She had picked up one day in the Montrose office all year long, and this was the day that she showed up. So she runs out and she gives me this big hug and said, "Robbie, what's going on?" "I found a guy." So we take her and her paramedic over to where Adam is. They start doing their trauma assessment. Her paramedic starts grabbing stuff to make interventions. She's like, "No, we got to do this on the helicopter, because if these guys don't get out of here soon, then we're going to be coming back for them." So before she leaves, I go up to her, "Kelly, please text Bree, let her know I'm okay." And she did, which was perfect, because right before Bree got the text, Logan found out from the GPS company saying, "Hey, we know that one of your two friends fell around 60 feet. They're in critical condition. We're trying to get them out now." But Kelly texted her, told her I was okay. It was fantastic. So after this, they fly away. We get back into the boat. And the problem here is we only have about 50 minutes of light. Not just sunshine, of light. Before, and we have to go through 5 miles of rapids. And don't you remember beforehand how I was telling you it's, you know, really good to do rapids in light and it's really hard to do it in the dark? So that whole scouting thing that we planned on doing, that's not going to happen. So we started going through the rapids. We went to this first rapid called the Squeeze, and it's a really, really tight slot, but we made it through. We came up to this rapid right here called Cable Rapid, and we always scout that. As you can see, you probably should be looking at that one beforehand. It's this really crazy right move that you got to make, and we somehow made it through. We finally came up to the grand finale. Let me describe this rapid for you. You got to squeeze in between two rocks on the right, go over about a 3-foot waterfall, come all the way back to the left side of the river. You got to ship your oars. In other words, put your oars to the front of the boat and then squeeze right between the cliff wall and a large boulder. You go over a 4-foot waterfall. And we made it. 5 minutes later, it was pitch black. You could not see anything. We spent the next 4 miles making it through just by, you know, sound. Let me go back to Adam. So this whole ordeal lasted 3 hours for him, between the time he fell and that he ended up making it to the emergency department. He got there, his core temperature was 35.8 degrees. Score. Hand warmers, yes! I can only imagine the nurses in the emergency department going, "Ooh, I found another one." After multiple surgeries, a couple weeks later, I saw him, well, a couple months later, and his kids and my kids were playing. He's like, "Robbie, I'm doing a lot better. I'm going to be able to get back to work." Eventually, we did a documentary, and I got to take him back to the place where he had fallen, where he had laid on the ground. And this picture right here totally describes Adam. If you got to the place where you thought you were going to die and this was the last place you were ever going to see, don't you think you'd get off the boat and just be like, "Whew." Oh, no, not Adam. He grabbed his fishing pole. He went right to the river. He's like, "I've been waiting 3 years to fish this spot." So when I reflect upon all the events that had to come together perfectly to make Adam's story not a tragedy, I think back to that time when I was 25 years old, living in my parents' house, working as a waiter, and how I gave up everything to become a raft guide. So if I can leave you with just one final point. It's this. Chase your dreams. You never know whose life you will change. Thank you.